our next award for single documentary, a familiar acting duo who, many years ago, spent a lot of time in an ice cream van. He has described his career as both highly colourful and eventful beyond his wildest dreams, starring alongside the likes of Clint Eastwood, Dudley Moore and John Hurt, and received critical acclaim as DCI Burke in Taggart. She starred in Gregory's Girl on the big screen and in Father Ted in EastEnders on the telly, whilst continuing her musical career with the fabulous Altered Images. Please welcome Claire Grogan and Alex Norton.
I'm a great fan of documentaries. I used to watch a series back in the 50s when STV started, John Grierson's This Wonderful World. And just about everything I ever learned, I learned from documentaries starting with this one. So I'm really privileged to be asked to present this award.
Was that in black and white?
Glasgow was in black and white then. Everything was in black and white.
Was that in the olden days, as my daughter Ellie says to me?
Live telly, like this. Oh God!
Shall we take a look at the nominations?
Let's.
Bridges are about connectivity between places, and big bridges capture the public's imagination.
Bridge is working very hard. It's not been designed for the level of traffic that it's taking today. It's taking almost 50% more load than it was ever designed for. All the traffic, all the load of, and the weight of the bridge is suspended in mid-air. Very simple. It's just like a rope bridge over the Andes, except it's made of steel.
Right, this time, ready? Okay. Excellent,
that was quite hard work, actually. Top of the N-Pin has been a dream of mine for years. It was quite an amazing moment when I was stood on top of the rock.
This is awesome! This is probably one of the coolest things I've ever done.
What does it feel like to lose your hair? You feel naked, you feel bare, you feel the person that was there has gone.
There is a grieving process. It's a loss of part of yourself. What makes you you?
And the winner is The Bridge, 50 years.
BAFTA Scotland, this is amazing. Thank you to our fellow nominees. I know everybody wanted Danny McCaskill to win so that we could see how he got on the stage. I know I did. This is officially the only time we'll be cooler than him, so 5 seconds if he'll allow us. For me, just as a director, you always have to thank your crew, cameraman and yeah, she came. Editor Phyllis, Stephen Mockery, and Phyllis Ironside, much thanks, and Kenny for his fantastic music. I really want to thank Colin and Morris. The best execs trust you to get on with the job. I think David Tennant said last year up here that you're not necessarily the best, you just got the best job, and in this case that was definitely the case, and Colin and Morris trusted me to get on with it, even when I told them I was 5 months pregnant, 4 weeks into the job. So that high up footage, I think I was 6 or 7 months pregnant by the time we went to the top of the bridge, and everybody let me go on with it. And I'll just let Morris take over in a minute, but I'll tell you that when I did tell Morris I was pregnant, he looked a bit stunned, but just did let me get on with it. But I think it all went okay when I told him that my baby was due on the 4th of September, which was the 50th anniversary of the bridge. And he was delivered on time and on budget, so as well as the programme. So hopefully that this can hang out in the playpen tomorrow. And thanks to my husband, who's on the number 61 bus, not getting here because there's no cabs. Anyway.
Thanks, Sarah. I'll be quick as well. Sarah was on time and on budget. The reason I was shocked was that the week before we'd done a recce to the top of the tower, and she hadn't mentioned she was 5 months pregnant. I'd like to thank you and Angus and David Harn at BBC Scotland for their help and support. I'd like to thank my wife Wendy for her similar support. And finally, I'd like to mention Jim Hendry and his family. Jim was the man who filmed the Fourth Road Bridge building for 6 years. And we acquired his film, 16 mil, shot in a Bolex, wonderful film. In 1966, he packed his camera away and went off to run a farm. And we came across his film many years later. So this is as much for him as for the rest of us. Thank you.
That was so close. I was so edging in for the yellow card. I am keeping them in here from now on, so I've got easier access. The speech doesn't have to be a documentary, I'm just saying. So on to Best Television Actor to announce the winner, an actress who starred in Doc Martin, The Bletchley Circle, and one of the fantastic cast of Shetland. Taking a break from shooting One of Us in the Highlands in Edinburgh, please give a huge welcome to Julie Graham.
Good evening. How are we? I've had the great pleasure of working with all these amazing actors. So without further ado, the nominations for Best Television Actor are...
You know this shit when they give birth.
I've heard that.
Yeah, well, I've seen it. I wouldn't want that
for you.
You'll never be able to forgive her.
Forgive her.
You see a little troll come tobogganing out of your wife's snatch on a wave of turds, and part of you will hold her responsible.
Now you're going to go away. And don't ever let me find out where you are. Because if I do, I'm going to have to come after you and I'm going to kill you.
You're all I've ever cared about.
Yeah. Care about something else.
Where were you the night Ollie went missing?
Working late, as usual. It's true, I promise. All I'm doing is trying to help you.
Your daughter, Molly. She didn't just walk out of the house that night, did she?
You be very careful what you say about my Molly.
And the winner is Ken Stoll. Ken is sadly unable to join us tonight, and he sent this speech of acceptance. I'm sorry I can't be with you this evening, but I'd like to thank the Academy and to send my very best wishes to Mark and Peter. I was delighted to be nominated for The Missing at BAFTA in London, but it makes me particularly proud to have been nominated and to receive it here in my home country. I'd like to thank Harry and Jack, Kate Rhodes-James, Ben Shankland, Chris Clough, New and Company Pictures and all at the BBC, and I wish you all a very happy evening. And we'd just like to wish Ken a speedy recovery, and we'll make sure that this gets to him. Thank you very much.
Now it's time to find out about our first special award this evening, Outstanding Contribution to Broadcasting. To present the award, he's the former head of Channel 4's Nations and Regions and director of Creative Diversity, a consummate journalist and broadcaster and passionate, over-passionate football fan who left Channel 4 to focus on other projects. His first book on music, Detroit 67, published early this year, was inspired by watching the film Dreamgirls and puts politics and soul in the Motown melting pot. We've given him another project to use his considerable eloquence to introduce tonight's worthy recipient. Please welcome one of Scotland's national treasures, Stuart Cosgrove.
Well, thank you very much indeed for that welcome. I want to talk tonight about Dorothy Byrne. Dorothy is a remarkable figure in the history of British television, a woman who personifies the best public service values of analysis, of scepticism, and of a healthy distrust for authority. Her most remarkable ability is to challenge the lazy orthodoxies that so often settle on television and on our public life, the ones that tell us that viewers want to be comforted, that they seek celebrities or are only interested in the subjects that directly affect them. She's pioneered the very opposite, often championing difficult subject matters or taking innovative approaches that require the viewer to stop what they're doing. There's a waspish side to Dorothy that I've always warmed to, and whilst we were both part of the senior management team at Channel 4, neither of us fully embraced the compromises of management. Recently, against the grain of mainstream thinking, Dorothy argued for a greater commitment to tougher international subjects, whether it was homophobic violence in oligarchic Russia or sexual grooming in the Muslim streets of Yorkshire. She is a hearty defender of Channel 4 News, whether it was threatened by the cold winds of commerce or the more subtle pressures of regulation. Dorothy helped me deliver on my obligations by helping spread the Paralympic ideal into mainstream news and programming by taking on new and emergent disabled talent and giving them new opportunities, not least Adia Depitan, a disabled sports presenter who was transformed into an undercover reporter investigating the treatment of the disabled in his native Nigeria, or the violent coercion of young gay men in Jamaica. That said, I have a reason, a very personal reason, to curse Dorothy Byrne. Many of you will remember I was arrested in Sri Lanka, accused by the now deposed Rajapaksa regime of being a collaborator with Tamil militants, my wife, and of producing an anti-government film. It was uncomfortable being bundled out of the country by military goons and being banned from re-entry, but all of us knew it was an important film and one that has since been endorsed not only by the United Nations, but acknowledged by the new Sri Lankan government and may yet lead to the prosecution and war crime tribunals. Dorothy is a towering figure who is part of Scotland's rich diaspora of talent, and you know that I believe that too much of our talent leaves too soon. But let's take a look at some of Dorothy's work.
She's a mentor, a disciplinarian. I certainly know when she rings me up and says, John, I'm sorry, they're not very happy about what you've said on Twitter. Boy, do I listen.
Working with or working for Dorothy really is a crazy mix of brilliance and insanity.
Sagacious, creative, dogged, and above all, a really warm and witty colleague.
She's just a joy to work with.
I'll be speaking like this about my friend Dorothy. Dorothy Byrne.
This is the story of one miraculous survivor, pulled from the rubble of Haiti's devastating earthquake. An 8-week-old baby girl.
And so I assume that President Mugabe has banned journalists from going to Zimbabwe because he doesn't want the world to know what he's up to.
Our concern is still the same, and that is that it's the ordinary Afghan people who are suffering the most.
Gritty, inspiring, a force of nature, the likes of which probably doesn't exist anywhere else in British broadcasting.
She's defended news and current affairs on Channel 4 with incredible determination and tenaciousness.
Constantly putting pressure on us journalists, on Channel 4 News, on dispatches, to think of new ways of looking at the world, turning it upside down.
And it's because of her that Channel 4's journalism is as robust and powerful as it is.
An extraordinary number of people in your own party hate you. Why do they hate you? What about the deficit?
The deficit is an important issue.
Well, you forgot to mention it.
Well, I said that we would not.
That's the second time.
Are you still writing to ministers letters like that?
It's been a pretty smooth ride for the SNP throughout this election campaign.
How the Yes campaign came from nowhere to frighten the life out of Westminster. Just look behind me.
Dorothy, you once remarked in a newspaper interview that there were so few senior women in TV that they must all be dead. So you are a rarity, a hugely inspirational, hugely successful woman in TV.
But what is it about Paisley, where she was born? It must be the water or something that's produced so many great journalists.
What's the chemistry like between you and Kay Burley?
Oh, it's explosive. I can't begin to tell you.
Do you think Jeremy Paxman is a suitable person to do your event tonight? I mean, Labour think he's a bit of a Tory.
He's a very suitable person.
But
he's one of the most
revered... He was considering standing as a Conservative in Kensington and Chelsea only a few weeks ago.
The first time I spoke to Dorothy Byrne, I was actually at the BBC, and she'd phoned me up. She wanted me to come and see her about the job here. And she said to me on the phone, it all had to be very, very secret, so she said to me, we should meet an Army and Navy cafe. She says it's full of spies and old ladies, so no one will spot us. She'll kill me for that impression, obviously. Anyway, as I was walking into the cafe at Army and Navy, I saw David Dimbleby on his way out. I thought, God, if he's in for it, I'm not going to get it.
Dorothy has got this very warm, soft personality, which hides a rather forensic mind.
Where are you travelling from?
I want to travel from Manchester, Victoria.
Right. I'll look for departures from Kyle Blockhouse, Highland.
A couple of years ago, we came across this really disturbing case of a guy who was basically a nasty sexual predator, and the police weren't going to do anything about it. And I knew that Dorothy and Channel 4 were the only people who would take this up, and she commissioned us to do a sting on this guy.
After making it clear our reporter would get cash for her studies in return for being sexually intimate with sponsors, Lancaster told her the interview would involve dressing up and having her photo taken.
He's in jail now, and it's really because of her and her bravery to take on something like this. It's typical of her.
She massively cares about subjects, so she has passions, whether it's Syria or Iraq or refugees or whatever it might be. She gets obsessed by these things, and she keeps on and on and on until she gets what she wants. But for the last 2 years, Channel 4 has been compiling our own dossier of video evidence and eyewitness accounts. We believe this footage represents devastating evidence of war crimes and crimes against humanity.
I don't think any of us realised what we were starting off on. I mean, we've been accused of faking the evidence, you know, we've been accused taking bribes, we've been given death threats.
Just a few miles away, in the so-called no-fire zone, increased government shelling and incursions by government troops were bringing death and terror to the crowded civilian camps.
Dorothy never for one second wavered in her defence of that story and her determination to tell the truth, and she made sure that Channel 4 didn't waver and stuck with it as well. And now, to an extent, I don't think any of us expected, the world is beginning to accept our evidence and is beginning to act on it.
She has, you know, as far as I'm concerned, fought for all the right causes, for all the dispossessed, and has made Channel 4 News something very special.
you're one of the very, very few people in television who cares so passionately about what you're doing and the people who work for you. And I'm really, really pleased that you have been recognised.
This award tonight is totally deserved. Congratulations, Dorothy.
I'll be forever grateful to you, Dorothy. You've been, and your support has been incredible. And I think that for a whole generation of victims of that war in Sri Lanka, they have very good cause to be very, very grateful to you as well.
I love you. You're fantastic. And once again, congratulations. Lucky old BAFTA.
You deserve everything you get today, and thank you very much for everything.
Dorothy, you've been shattering glass ceilings before they were invented. Many congratulations on yet another one.
Congratulations and loads of love, Dorothy, from me, that funny guy in the odd ties.
Dorothy, come on up. I think it should be said. Dorothy Byrne. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you very much, and some fantastic testimony there. Tonight, I'm actually acting as a substitute because the award should have been presented by the peerless Jon Snow, who's been rushed to Paris to present Channel 4 News live from the tragic city tonight. But Jon has sent this message this morning. Dorothy, you're a dominant part of the DNA and the very backbone of what defines Channel 4. You're our conscience, our imagination, and our inspiration. We are defying the grim gloom of Paris tonight to congratulate you in our hearts with love from John and the whole Channel 4 news team in Paris tonight and beyond. Dorothy, well done. Fantastic.
Thank you. Well, first I should say that I'm very conscious tonight that as we're celebrating, the Channel 4 news team is covering that terrible story. And I would like to tell you that nearly all of that team volunteered to work on the programme the moment they heard what had happened. And I'd like to pay tribute to what I believe to be the team of the best news programme in the world. I was very moved by that film. I felt many red cards passing, it was so long. But I'm so moved to be receiving this award from BAFTA Scotland, because to be honoured in your homeland is really everyone's dream. I'm very glad that we are making more current affairs out of Scotland now. But may I also say that I'm very glad that Paisley is being shortlisted as City of Culture. And I have to be duly impartial, but it would be a great choice. Not least because of the way that it welcomes visitors. Today I took my daughter there and said, we're going to go back to the house I first lived in 63 years ago. I'm going to go into the house and look at my old bedroom. And she said, Mum, they'll never let you do that. Because, I mean, she imagines it would be like London, where they would just call the police. But I would like to thank Frank and Marion Ford, who let me in. They let me in my bedroom and even theirs. But I'm afraid that tonight I have to tell you something also that you're not going to like very much. I used to work on ITV in the golden age of
current affairs there on World in Action. And when I realised that the commercial pressures on ITV, which I completely understand, meant that they couldn't have a programme like World in Action in prime time in that way, I went to Channel 4. And I know that Margaret Thatcher's not very popular in this country, but it was Margaret Thatcher and the Conservatives who came up with the fantastic idea of Channel 4. And that is what has enabled me to do what is my best work in my life, working with 50 production companies a year and with the fantastic ITN news team. And if it wasn't for the Tories, ironically, to some of you, that wouldn't have been possible. And it's a fantastic model which costs nothing. It's a public service that costs nothing at all and which actually works. And we don't get many of those in this country. So I would just say that I know that George Osborne is perhaps, from what I've read, currently considering whether he should love it or list it. And George, because I have to be duly impartial, I'm not allowed to tell you not to list it, but I beg you, please love it.
Category of film actress. We have a hugely talented film, television and stage actor and director who's appeared in countless TV shows and films from Trial and Retribution to The Paradise by way of Shetland and from Sid and Nancy to Hope and Glory. He's found time along the way to present some seriously good documentaries and spot the odd protege like James McAvoy and Robert Carlyle. You can see him at a cinema near you now as Lennox in the fantastic Macbeth. But we've managed to get him here tonight in person. Please welcome David Heyman.
Hello. Now, you know, it's a sheer joy once a year to get together with your friends and peers and colleagues and enemies to, and those you want to stab in the fucking back, to celebrate the best of our industry. And, you know, we are very, very blessed in our wee, smashing, small country of Scotland, because out of 5.5 million people, we have a genuine abundance of talent right across the creative disciplines in Scotland, and not least in film and television. So to all of you nominees out there tonight, I say, whether you win or whether you lose, take great heart and great pride from the fact that your work has been recognised as among the best in the country this year. And your faces are noted. Ladies and gentlemen, let us look at the nominees for Best Film Actress.
Come on, David. You have to admit she's fascinating. I mean, you should have heard her on the phone. She's been a naturist, a tantric couples therapist, a bondage mistress. I mean, how many women her age?
She's a freak, obviously.
She might even be able to get to the bottom of your problems. Sorry. Our problems.
Back in California, I was a polyandrist. There was Jago and Tom, Sally and Yvette. Yvette was a transsexual from Warhol's factory. We lived together like one big couple for 3 years. We had Rhodas for everything, gardening, cooking, even bonking, of course. The men rarely did the dishes, though. We agreed to do this water-only diet and have 30 tantric orgasms a day.
Wow.
Give you terrible diarrhea.
Some things never change.
Can you be a fish stopper? Get off!
But did it?
Aye.
Tips.
One.
Tell you what. Hand him over to me, and I'll put him on the next race.
No, you're all right.
Matthew Leopard. 3-1.
No, I'm no thanks.
Oh, come on.
No.
Fiver gets you 15 quid.
Well, I'm not getting any money.
Nah. Who'd ever tip you? Not me.
And the winner is the deliciously over-the-top Emma Thompson.
Unfortunately, not Emma Thompson. I'm Colin McLaren. I had a hand in this thing. And I just want to say, on her behalf, I mean, she had an absolute ball making this film. I think it comes across on the screen. And to be in the company of Elizabeth and Elena tonight, the competition is fantastic. So thanks, Emma. Thanks, BAFTA. Wahey.
Now on to short film, and tonight's nominees demonstrate a broad range of cutting-edge work. To name and acclaim the winner of short film, a director who made his mark with the bombastic and absolutely brilliant Filth last year, took over reins of Danny Boyle's cop drama Babylon, and has recently been working closely with the legendary, you know, Martin Scorsese on the HBO series Vinyl. Please give a huge warm welcome to the brilliant John S. Baird.
Great to be back in Scotland. Thanks very much, BAFTA, for inviting me up here to do this. It's lovely to see so many old friends and wonderfully talented people here tonight. So without further ado, let's go and have a look at the nominations for Best Short Film.
It's obviously not even that bad these days. This is going to be like your Auntie Jenny's old caravan compared to back in my day.
Well, no home yet.
It's Duncan, me man.
Duncan who?
Mackenzie, friend of Rab's. Where could you go?
Just ginger.
Fuck that. 2 pints, 2 whiskies.
What'd you say your name was again?
Duncan fucking Mackenzie.
Sorry, Duncan.
What?
I'll get your drinks.
Aye. You jog on.
Robert, have you read that book? Have you read it yet? Now, if you're not going to read it, give it back, because there's after people in you that need it. I thought you were sensible, son, you would get through that in a week. That's what Archie said to me. A week! I've said to him, I'm reading it at dinner times and I'm reading it in the evening. Well, that's not enough, is it? And it wasn't. So I read it within the next week.
Okay, and the winner is Mining Poems or Ode.
Thank you.
very much, BAFTA. It's my first short film we've ever made, so never done this before. So, Robert Fullerton, who's from Govan, he's a poet now, he used to work in the shipyards. He sent me some lines to read tonight, so he wanted me to read. Robert Fullerton is an incredibly talented guy. Callum was very privileged to work with him, shine a light on him, and the Scottish Documentary Institute were very kind to let him do that. So I'd like to thank Creative Scotland, Scottish Documentary Institute, the guys at Sirius that work in Govan Town Hall, Hopscotch Films helped me as well, and of course Jack, great producer.
And so to the award for writer, a category which truly reflects not just the quality but the breadth of work done this year in film and television. To tell us who's been voted the pick of a very fine bunch, please welcome broadcaster, author and journalist Muriel Gray.
Okay, this is a very important category because there's lots and lots and lots of people out there in the audience who are writers and nobody knows who they are. They're completely anonymous, you never get any praise at all, no one stops you in the street. But they would be nothing without you because you make stuff up. So everything comes from the writer. Can I also just use this opportunity to say that the gorgeous, beautiful, brand new BAFTA statue that you're all getting is by GSA graduate Oliver Conway, who's here tonight. Oliver! Yeah! 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 Never off duty. Let's have a look at the nominations.
Please don't bring them back in. Stay quiet.
Shh. Falcon gun. A soldier? A real soldier?
Get up. Pack your bags.
What's going on? What's happened to her? Why are you crying?
She's single. Helena McLeod is single and she's having a party. I need you to drive me to the Highlands.
Evie's coming over to see us. I'm not driving you up there.
What's the point in me buying a car if you're not going to drive me places?
Book your driving test.
Helena is my 50-year storm, Dylan.
What are you talking about?
What am I talking about? What are you talking about? Point Break. 50-year storm at the end. Bodie not coming back.
I've never seen it.
You've never? What the? What is wrong with you people? Okay, I'll talk you through it when we're leaving.
I am not a hero. I'm definitely not a president. And no, I'm not an officer. You know what I am? I am an idiot with a box and a screwdriver. Passing through, helping out, learning. I don't need an army. I never have, because I've got them.
Always them.
Because love. It's not an emotion. Love is a promise.
And the winner is Gregory Burke.
Gregory, unfortunately, can't be here this evening, but he sent me just a short message he'd like to share with you. Thank you to BAFTA Scotland for this award. Leslie Finlay, who's collecting the award on my behalf, introduced myself and Angus Lamont of Crab Apple Films in the hope that Angus might be able to help me with a couple of ideas. It wasn't a good meeting.
Angus was open and brutally dismissive of all the ideas I pitched him, and I thought his idea of a film set in Belfast in the early 70s about a missing soldier being chased by different paramilitary factions sounded like a bad rip-off of Mel Gibson's Apocalypto. However, from that waste of everybody's time came 71. Just shows you how much I know. I'd like to thank Angus and also Robin Gooch of Wart Films. The script wouldn't have been what it was without their brilliant support. Also thanks to the director, Jan Demange, who continued to develop it with me through to shooting. Thanks also to Leslie Finlay and Creative Scotland for developing it in the first place, and to Tessa Ross and Sam Lavender at Film 4. Finally, Lizzie Frankie at the BFI, Dan McCrae at Studio Canal, and Andrew Reid at Northern Ireland Screen. Thank you all.
Tonight's next category is television drama, and the ingredients we just love: conflict, contradiction, excitement, danger, laughter, and a few tears. To present the award, she picked up the BAFTA for Best TV Actress for the incredible Murdered by My Boyfriend, also soon to be seen in One of Us. Georgina Campbell. With her is that in-demand actor from The Crow Road, Heartbeat, Casualty and Holby City, Joe McFadden. Yes, foolish as we are.
It's a real pleasure to be here tonight. I'm sure everyone's very hungry and just wants us to get on with it. So,
I'm so hungry that I could probably stomach some haggis right now. Which,
watch it.
No, probably not.
But and the nominees
are. Nominees are.
You shouldn't be able to come into someone's house in the middle of the night and drag them away. It's wrong.
Well, what time of day should they come then, darling? Should they make a wee convenient appointment that fits their schedule? Listen, I like you, Grimms, but you're so naive it's a joke.
Maybe it was naive to think that people would want to help us. But that's what you do, isn't it? When you're scared, you ask for help. Well, we're scared. We're scared because the Home Office is coming in the middle of the night to take people like us away.
She didn't know what to leave the lassie in case the birds come back. I've been pecking.
Detective Inspector Perez.
Jess Collins. Her name's Catherine Ross. She babysits for me. She's 17.
You seriously think I would do that to my own son? If you had a good reason. If he betrayed you, maybe betrayed me.
Betrayed me? What kind of shit? Have you been putting into my daughter's head?
Don, be careful. It's not worth it.
I thought it had something to do with what Grave told you. But you knew about the deal he made with Mike and you decided he had to be taught a lesson. Didn't you? Didn't you? What deal? What are you talking about? What deal? What's he talking about?
And the winner is Glasgow Girl. And she thanks, BAFTA Scotland, for this award. I should thank the people of Drumchapel who came out in their droves to help us make the film, the people of Glasgow, an amazing cast and crew, amazing producers, Colin, Kate, Anna. But yeah, most importantly, should thank the real Glasgow girls who let us tell their amazing, moving, inspiring story. And I think the story, given current world events, gets more and more important. A story about compassion and human decency. I'm very nervous. I'm going to pass it over to Emma, one of the Glasgow girls. They're never short of a few words, so
thank you. First of all, I'd like to say a big thank you to Brian and the team for doing such a wonderful job of telling our story, and to the other Glasgow girls who can't make it here tonight, particularly Gnessa, who's recovering in the hospital randomly, but she's fine, don't worry. I mean, we thought things were tough, 10 years ago, but I mean, we are facing the worst humanitarian crisis since the Second World War in terms of refugees. So sorry to kind of lower the mood a wee minute and be serious, but there's some serious issues we need to look at when it comes to refugees. Following the tragic events in Paris, I mean, I look at my Facebook and it's all anti-refugee, anti-Muslim, and that makes me sad. And I just want to say that I don't want that to fracture our communities. We need to stand together and remember that refugees are running from the very people carrying out these atrocities. So thank you again.